Hello everyone. In this video, we are going to learn about shared and dynamic linking and also learn how we can find main function inside of a strip binary. So without further ado, let's just start it. So in this, we have a simple hello.c program in which we are calling two functions, which is printf. Now we can compile this by using gcc minus g for debug symbols and passing it an output of hello. Now we can execute it. Now to get the information about the generated executable, you can use the file command, which we have learned about it and we learned about the gdb. We can see here that it is a 64-bit PIE executable having a dynamic linked interpreter as the ldlinux.so file, and it is a non-strip binary. Since this binary is dynamically linked, we can use the ldd command, which stands for list dynamic dependencies, and see what this executable depends on. So we can see here that it depends on Linux VDSO and libc. So we can here see that in the second line that it points to the directory where our libc is located, and the bracket contains the address at which the libc is located. When we run this ldd commands many times, we can see that the libc library will be located at random addresses because the ASLR is enabled on this machine. So whenever we run the ldd command, we will see a different address of the libc library. Now let's have a look at this binary inside of Ghidra. We open Ghidra and from functions tab we go to the main function. We see here that our main function consists of two puts call. The call to puts is there because of there is no format specifier inside of the printf function that we used. So the compiler has changed the call to printf to puts. Now when we navigate to the puts function, it shows we can see here that this puts function is a thunk function. We can click on the first xref, which points to the thunk function, and we jump to the puts function inside of the .plt section. This function consists of three instructions, which is a jump to qwordptr puts, pushing a value of 0, and jumping to an address. When we navigate to this jump function, we can see here that this is inside the PLT section, and it pushes some value and it jumps to an address which is inside the global offset table. So the first instruction inside of the thunk int puts function, there is a call to jump qwordptr puts, and this puts function and this puts points to an address which is located inside of the global offset table. When we click on it, we can see that it is inside of the global offset table. In case of a dynamically linked executable, when this executable is loaded inside of memory, the loader does not know where the function puts or printf is located. So it goes through a series of address lookup through the PLT and GOT table. So the PLT stands for procedure linkage table, which is used to call external procedures or functions whose addresses isn't known at the time of linking, and it is resolved by the dynamic linker at runtime. And the global offset table is similarly used to resolve addresses, so the PLT and GOT works hand in hand. So whenever a function like printf is called from a shared library, the linker makes a jump to an address in the PLT section first. When the puts function is called for the first time, it goes to the three instructions that we saw, that is the jump, push and jump. So the first jump instruction, which is a jump keyword ptr puts, reads an address from the got.plt section. So since it is called for the very first time, the address of the puts function is not resolved yet. So when we see the entry at that particular address, it points to the PLT section. And this jump jumps to the next instruction, that is push 0x0. And the next instruction jump and lab 101020 jumps to the PLT section. And this is where the DL runtime resolve function, which resolves the actual addresses, is called. Now let's have a look it inside of the GDB, and when we step through the code, it will become more clear. Let's load it into GDB and disassemble the main function. We break it at the main function and run using the R command. We can see that it has broken at the instruction LEA RDI RIP plus 0xEC4. So we step through this function and go to the first call to puts@plt. We step into this function and we can see that the first call is the call to jump function. It is calling the address located at RIP plus 0xFE2. To have a look at what is located at this address, we can use the examine command, which is x, and specify in which format we want to look the address. So we want to see addresses in hex, and we want to see three addresses at that location. So when we use x by 3gx and paste the address, we can see that it points to the got.plt section, and the first address that is there is pointing to the next instruction, that is push 0. And we have to remember this location, because when the addresses will be resolved after this call, the absolute address of puts function will be located here. Now we step through this instruction and we land at the push 0 instruction. We again step through it and jump to this address. Now we are in the .plt section, as we saw earlier inside of Ghidra. We see that there is a push and jump. We push a particular address and jump to the DL runtime resolve xsave. And this is where the runtime resolution of the printf function, of the puts function, is being done. Now that we have jumped inside of the runtime resolve, we can either step through it or we can just use the finish command to execute till return. We execute the finish command and we land at the next instruction inside of main, which is LEA RDI RIP plus hex EC7, and next is a call to puts PLT function. Let's step through this instruction and we can see that at this location earlier, there was a jump to the next instruction, which was push 0, but now it is loaded with an absolute address to the function puts. If we go back and have a look at the puts got.plt address, we can see that in the first 8 bytes, we can see that it has the address of the puts function. because it was resolved with the previous puts instruction, puts function. Now inside of this program, whenever we call the puts function, the runtime resolution will not take place, as it only takes place for the first time, and for the consecutive calls, the absolute address is taken from the got.plt section. Now that we have taken a look at the dynamic linked executable, we can also see some information about this executable by using the readelf command. The -h parameter is passed to see the headers within this executable. We can see that this belongs to elf64 and the type is a dyn, which is a shared object file. We can see that the entry point address is not an absolute address but an offset, which will be changed when the executable will be loaded inside of the memory. Now let's compile this program hello.c into a static executable. We can do this by passing minus static flag. Let's get the information from this static executable that we have created by using the file command. We can see that this is a elf64 lsb executable and it is statically linked. We can get the header information from this executable and we can see that the type is exec, which is an executable file, and the entry point is hex401ac0, and this will be always be loaded at this particular entry point, and this entry point will always be fixed whenever this executable is executed. And comparing the type with the previous executable that we created, the earlier was shared object file and this is a true executable file. Let's have a look at this executable inside of Ghidra. We go to a main function. When you try to load a statically linked executable inside of Ghidra, it will take quite a lot of time to analyze this executable, because all the libraries, the libc or the function, are inside of this executable and have to be analyzed by Ghidra, and this analysis can take quite a lot of time. We can see that in the functions tab there are 979 function items that are included in this simple hello.c program because it is statically linked. Now when we go to a main function and click on puts, we can see that the puts function is directly included inside of this statically linked executable, and the addresses will always remain fixed when we run this. Let's have a look at this executable inside of GDB. But before that, let's compare the size of the dynamically linked executable and statically linked executable. And we see that the size of statically linked executable is quite large compared to dynamically linked. Now let's open it in GDB and break at main function. We see that when there is a call to puts function, it directly jumps to the implementation of puts and there is no resolution or that kind of stuff happening inside of this. In case of dynamically linked executable, the addresses of the external functions are resolved by the runtime resolver, whereas inside of the statically linked executable, the addresses are itself placed when the executable passes through the linking process. To find the main function inside of an executable, if you don't have the debug symbols inside of that, if the executable is not compiled with debug symbols, you can go to libc start main and see where this function is called from. It is usually called from the underscore start function. And before that, we can see that there is a lea rdi main. And since this executable contains debug symbols, we can see the address is resolved. But when there is no debug symbols, the lea rdi will have an address that points to the main function. You can strip all the debug symbols from the executable by using the strip command and passing it a flag strip unneeded. And when we see the size of the executable after stripping, we can see that the size has reduced significantly. Now let's load this strip binary inside of Ghidra and try to locate the main function. I have to remove this executable as both have the same name. Let's first close all this that has been opened right now. Let's remove this and try to import the new strip binary. Okay. Click on OK and double click. Let's analyze this. Click on analyze. And now the start function is replaced by the entry function. And we can see that by going to the lea rdi func 101135, and that function points to a main function. So you can use this technique to find the main function if there is no debug symbols inside any executable. So that's all for this video. In the next lesson, we will be learning about the basic bug classes that we find generally inside of the C and C++ programs. So we will learn about stack-based buffer overflow and try to write our own ROP exploit inside of Windows. So that's all for this video. I hope you learned something out of this and enjoyed it. Thank you and have a nice day.